What I'm going to do in the next few lectures is go over a lot of work that I've done, I cannot believe it, over the last 41 years. It's hard to believe when you've been doing linguistics for 41 years. But let me try to give you some sense of the difference between linguistics today and linguistics 41 years ago. What has happened since then and why? There's an enormous change that has come about in linguistics. And the reason is that people simply have become linguists and studied things, discovered more things. And the other reason is that with the development of cognitive science, that is the study of the mind and the study of the brain, we have learned a lot about what it is to be a human being. And language depends a great deal about what it is to be human. So what we will see as we go along is that we are discovering not merely technical things about language, but rather a great deal about what it means to be a person. That's really what these lectures are about why it is that you study linguistics. My first linguistics teacher was a great linguist, Roman Jakobson. My other second linguistics teacher was another great linguist, Noam Chomsky. They had two opposite views. Roman Jakobson viewed language as central to all human activity. What he said was this, that when you study language, you study everything. That to study language is to study thought, to study language is to study interpersonal communication, to study anthropology, to study the way people interact with one another. And it requires fitting language into the web of science, fitting it into how science works, how physics works in, let's say, acoustics, how the brain works, and so on. It is a lesson I have never forgotten, and I think it's an extremely important one that we will see. The other view from my other teacher, Professor Chomsky, is that language is the opposite, completely autonomous, independent of all communication, independent of thought, independent of the body, independent of interpersonal relationships, and so on. I've never believed that. I've been more a follower of Professor Jakobson. And you will see as we go along that I think the evidence shows that Professor Jakobson had the better idea. But we will see as we go along what the evidence is. Let me begin with a view of linguistics from 1963, when I first started doing it. In 1963, the study of meaning was the study of formal logic. My own training, my background was at MIT, the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, a technical university where I studied mathematics and English literature both. And one of the things that I learned I learned to do both the study of meaning from the perspective of literature, but also the study of logic, mathematical logic. And mathematical logic had certain properties which were inherited from Aristotle. That is, mathematical logic as it developed was a philosophical endeavor. And it assumed certain very interesting things. Things which are not necessarily true, but interesting. These came from 22,500 years ago in Greece. The idea then, as Aristotle constructed logic, Aristotle assumed that meaning was out there in the world. That the meanings of words were essences of things out there in the world, that the mind could directly grasp the world, and that logic was the logic not of the human mind necessarily, it could be of the human mind, but it was the logic of the world. And if you were smart, you could grasp the logic of the world with your mind. That was the assumption. And that assumption carried through up until 1963. It was assumed that the study of logic was the study of all rational structure in the universe, and mathematical logic was supposed to be the mathematics of that structure, and that rational thought mimicked the structure of the universe. That was an assumption just taken for granted about the nature of reasoning and logic. Now, logic, of course, could also be a purely mathematical endeavor. There are all sorts of logics that are made up by mathematicians that have nothing to do with the world. So if you're a mathematician and you look at pure mathematical logic, it doesn't matter. You can make up all sorts of logics. And there are tens of thousands of logics that logicians have made up. But the general philosophical assumption when I came into linguistics was that the study of meaning was the study of the way words fit the world. That was the assumption. How does language fit onto the structure of the world? And that the structure of the world was to be characterized in terms of logic. Now, there was another assumption that came from the modern theory of logic. And that was that logic was formal. There was a formal structure to logic. And that formal structure had certain properties. And we'll go through them in a minute. We'll check and see how they worked. At the same time, Noam Chomsky came along. And in 1957, he wrote a book called Syntactic Structures. And in that book, he introduced a metaphor into the study of linguistics, a very powerful metaphor. He said that a sentence is a string of symbols. Now, when he said that, he was referring to a form of mathematics, which was the theory of symbol manipulation. It is called recursive function theory. Sometimes called the theory of formal languages. And it is a theory of how symbols get moved around without regard to their meaning and what regularities you could find by studying systems of symbols. This theory is the basis for computer science. In addition, Chomsky assumed that a language was a set of such sequences of symbols, and that a grammar was a system for generating that set. And when he said that, he was referring to, again, the mathematics of recursive function theory. In short, he was claiming that a language was a purely mechanical system for manipulating symbols in some regular fashion by rules, and that they had nothing to do with meaning, nothing to do with communication, and as a mathematical system, didn't even have anything necessarily to do with the fact that you have a brain, a body, or anything else. It was a disembodied mathematical system. So that generative grammar, as it was characterized back in 1963, was as this symbol system, had nothing to do with meaning, and that you could then hook it up to meaning by relating it to the structure of the world and to logic. As a student of Chomsky's, I did a lot of work on this theory. I did many investigations of phenomena from the point of view of this theory, got to know it very well, and I soon began to suspect that it didn't work very well. And the part that didn't work very well had to do with the claim that the structure of language has nothing to do with meaning, that the structure of language has nothing to do with social interaction or context or communication. Because it seemed to me, as I started looking at examples, that it had everything to do with meaning, communication, social interaction, relationships between people, and so on. Let me try to give you some examples of what I began to find. And as I did this, I tried to take the theory of meaning in logic and apply it to meaning in linguistics. So during the first 12 years of my career as a linguist, I did what was called generative semantics. That is, I was trying to apply logic to the study of meaning in language and account for syntax in terms of properties of meaning. So that is what I'm going to talk about. Let me give you a few examples. Have any of you know, any of you know the game of baseball? Okay. In baseball, you hit a ball, and there are certain verbs you use to describe hits, like single, double, triple. So you can say, he doubled to left field, or he doubled off the wall in left field. Now, the expression off the wall or to left field, those are prepositional phrases, very familiar to you. And they are directional prepositional phrases. They describe the direction in which something moves. Now, in a Chomskyan theory with pure symbols, if you have a sentence like, John doubled off the wall, the only way you could ask how off the wall fit with double is to have off the wall just fit with this verb, this symbol. But if you ask, what is the general principle by which you can account for where the phrase off the wall occurs? Is there a generalization about it? It appears that it has to do with meaning. When you say he doubled off the wall, the off the wall refers to the ball moving off the wall. If you say he doubled to left field, it means the ball went to left field. That is, to left field describes the direction of the movement of the ball. And if you had a verb where there was no movement of an object, you could not get off the wall or to left field. You can't say, he slept to left field, or he slept off the wall, right? There's no movement of an object. If I say, he fell, I mean, you don't fell if you use movement. But if you say something like, he sat, you can't say, he sat to left field. Okay? The generalization is in the meaning. It's not in the grammar. But for Chomsky, everything that put phrases together had to do with the symbols and the grammar, not with the meaning. And when you find that a generalization about how things fit together is about meaning, then that violates the theory. It violates the theory that grammar has only to do with the way symbols fit together and not with their meaning. Okay? Let me give you many other examples of this. I want to give you a sense of how broad this is. Suppose that you look at certain expressions in English that occur only with negatives, but not with positives, sentences. So there are sentences like, take the word ever. E-V-E-R, ever. You can say, I didn't ever see him. Okay? But you can't say, I ever saw him. Ever only goes with negatives. Not ever, but not simply, I ever saw him. Impossible. In normal sentences. Now, there are some cases, some kinds of sentences, where you have a negative meaning and a positive grammar, and a negative grammar with a positive meaning. These are special constructions in English. For example, if I say to you, why paint your house purple? There's no subject, there's no auxiliary, and what I'm saying is, I'm suggesting that perhaps you should not paint your house purple unless you have a good reason. Right? And if I say, why not paint your house purple? I'm suggesting you should paint your house purple unless you have a good reason not to. Okay? So why not is a positive suggestion, and why is a negative suggestion in this construction only. That is where there's no subject and no auxiliary. So why not paint your house purple? Why paint your house purple? Now, the question is this. If you have a negative grammar with a positive meaning, does ever do words like this, these negative polarity items, do they go with the grammar or with the meaning? Right? The theory that says grammar is about symbol manipulation says it should go with the grammar. The theory that says it is about meaning says it should go with the meaning. So we test. You can say, if you try to say, why not ever help him? Doesn't work. But why ever give him any money? It's okay. If you say, there are expressions like give a damn. Why, you can say, I don't give a damn, not I give a damn. So you can say, why give a damn, but not why not give a damn. You can say things like, he doesn't have a red cent. It's an idiom that only occurs with negatives, not he has a red cent. You can say, why give him a red cent, but not why not give him a red cent. Impossible. These negative polarity items go with a negative meaning, not with a negative grammar. And that is profound, because it says that the combinations of words, which is what a syntax is about, is dependent upon the meaning of the sentence. It's not merely dependent upon the other words and the surface forms in the sentence. Okay? It's a very deep and important property. There are many cases like this, and let me give you some more. Take the English distinction between the words who and which. Now, who usually refers to a person, and which usually refers to something that's not a person. So I can say something like, the man who I saw, or the bicycle which I saw, but not the bicycle who I saw, and not the man which I saw. Okay? So who with people, which with non-people. But what do you say about a cat? Right. Now, if you have a pet cat, what do you say about your pet cat? It depends on how you think about your pet cat. So, you can say, my cat, who always tries to fool me, but my cat, which weighs 10 pounds. Now, if you say, my cat who weighs 10 pounds, you're talking about how much he eats, that he may be overeating a bit, may have a personality that does that. That is, when you say, use who, you are metaphorically attributing personhood to the cat. You know, try to fool you, maybe he's got a, you know, maybe he eats too much, whatever, but you're trying to attributing personality. If you're just viewing the cat as just a thing, then you use which. In short, the distribution between which and who, which is part of the grammar of English, depends upon the meaning, not just grammar. Right? It depends upon how you understand what a cat is. And it doesn't just depend upon the fixed meaning of the word. It depends on how you understand the meaning of the word in context. Right? That is the crucial thing. How you understand it in context. Now, that is an extremely important part of language, the way context works. And context works, this is the study of what is called pragmatics. Context has to do with how you fit things into your understanding of the world. One of the arguments that we have found, one of the results of generative semantics, is that the study of context is not separate from the study of meaning. Context is the semantics of the world, of your understanding of situations. It's the semantics of situations, the semantics of communication, of interpersonal communication. And there are generalizations about just that. Now, let me give you some examples of such generalizations. Suppose I have a sentence like, can you give me a cup of tea? Now, in English, there are expressions like, can you give me a cup of tea, which is literally a question about your ability. But it is actually a request to give you tea. Right? These are indirect speech acts. And I wrote a paper about these back in 1971 called Conversational Postulates. The idea here is that there is a systematic relationship between what you say and what you mean. There's a system behind it. When you say, can you, there's a reason why that is a request rather than a statement. There's a reason why it's a request and not a promise. And let me explain why. If you look at requests, as John L. Austin did, or John Searle, who have both written books on speech acts, they observe that requests have certain conditions. When you make a directive, a request, or give directions to someone to do something, an imperative sentence, what you're doing is this. You're assuming that you have the right to make the request first, that you're in a social position to do that. Second, you're assuming that the other person is willing to undertake this, that it's at least possible, and that the other person is able to do it. You generally don't make requests of the things that are that you know are impossible in a normal situation. Now, you might, for certain reasons, want to do this. For certain rhetorical reasons, you might want to request of something impossible of your parents, for example. But that's, those are special cases. In a normal request, you assume that someone can do it, that they will be willing to do it, that they would want that. And moreover, if you're making a request, it is assumed between you and the other person that you really want the request to be carried out. Okay? So look at the ways that you can use other sentences to make requests. You can say, I would like you to give me a cup of tea. I want a cup of tea. That is, you can express a desire. So this is one of the conditions of a request. You can request by giving a condition of a request. You can make a request by asking if someone is able to carry it out. That is, and being able to carry it out is a condition for the request. And so if they say yes, they're able to carry it out, it is like saying, yes, I will fulfill the request. So I say, can you pour me a cup of tea? You say yes. You don't just sit there. Say, can you pour me a cup of tea? You say yes. Do nothing. Right? It's socially not right. Because when you said yes, you actually said yes to, I will give you a cup of tea. I can say, will you give me a cup of tea? As this will happen in the future. That is, this future question about whether it will happen is one of the questions about, one of the conditions. So if you say yes, will you, then you're saying in the future you will, and that means you'll do it. So the conditions on requests can be stated or questioned in such a way that it can be used to evoke the rest of the request. In cognitive linguistics, this is called metonymy, where a part stands for the whole. Okay? And these are, the name for this phenomenon is indirect speech acts. Now, indirect speech acts are particularly interesting because of the phenomenon I just mentioned about, like, why paint your house purple? If I ask you something like, why aren't you doing your homework? Okay, I come and I ask you this negative question, why aren't you doing your homework? That is a suggestion that you should be doing your homework unless you have a good reason. Right? That is an indirect speech act. And why paint your house purple is an indirect speech act construction. It is a combination of the indirect speech act with why and the imperative paint your house purple. It is taking two constructions and parts of them and putting them together. Right? And this is called an amalgam. It is fitting two parts of a sentence together. And you fit them together under pragmatic conditions, conditions of communication, of successful communication. What that means is that you cannot, just by looking at the symbols themselves, fit them together. You have to know what they mean in a context. And this is the same as true with can you. So let me give you some examples of the difference of this. With can you open the door, the relationship between can you and the request is part of the conventional part of the language. It is a fixed construction of English. It is something you learn. You learn to do it by saying, can you? Okay. Now, there are other indirect ways of speaking that are not just part of the language, but that are still understood in context. Let me give you an example. Suppose I were to say to someone sitting next to the window, it's very, very hot in here, right? And you would jump up and open the window, right? Under these social situations, right? That you would feel impelled to open the window if you could. But that's not part of the grammar of English. To say, it's hot in here does not mean open the window. But in this situation, in this social situation, it would mean that, right? Now, notice that there is a grammatical difference between these. And here it is. Suppose you take the word please in English. The word please is used in a polite request. But you can put please in different parts of the sentence. You can say, please, can you open the window? Or, can you please open the window? And you might think that they're the same, but they are not. Okay, so here is a subtle difference in English that native speakers of English know. There's a difference between internal please and external please. And I'll give you the examples. I can, externally, no problem, I can say, please, can you open the window? Or I could say, please, it's hot in here. And then you open the window. I can say, can you please open the window? But I cannot say, it's please hot in here. Right? Because internal please goes exactly before the what I'm telling you to do, before the directive. So when it's inside, it goes before what I'm telling you to do. When it's outside, it just says, I'm making a polite request. Okay, but it's not necessarily right before it. So that's a special constraint on please. Okay? What does that mean for a theory of linguistics, for a theory of grammar? The combination of please, which is part of the grammar of English, with other words is part of syntax. It's part of grammar, how you put words together. But you cannot put please in the middle of a declarative sentence like, it's hot in here. You can't say, it's please hot in here. What is the principle? The principle is that when you put please in the middle of a sentence, it must go right before a directive that the sentence is grammatically giving. Okay? And that is a condition on speech acts. It's a condition on meaning in context. It is not just how you put the words together. So here you have another example of something in the grammar of English that does not just depend upon a formal system of symbol manipulation. It depends upon what you mean, how you are communicating with something else, and what are the principles of communication. Okay? So this says that pragmatics, the understanding of communication, is entering into the grammar of English. Okay? Now, these are very important results. Let me pause for a minute to just go over them. What they show is that the fundamental assumption made by Chomsky in his basic metaphor, remember the basic metaphor, a language is a sentence is a string of symbols, where a symbol is independent of a meaning. It's a meaningless symbol, just a bunch of symbols. A grammar is a set, in the sense of set theory, a mathematically precise notion, a set of such strings. And notice, what is a set and what is not a set is independent of context. Sets don't change with context. Sets are defined by their members, strictly, in mathematics. So you can't say, here's a set, but over there it's not a set. Right? You can't say, in this auditorium something's a set, in another auditorium it's not. So he says, this is a set, and the rules of English generate that set without looking at meaning. Right? It's false. It does not apply to real English. All the examples we've just given you are cases where meaning matters, where context matters, and where communication matters. Okay, for when things can fit together. So this is crucial to an understanding of what's going on. Now, what was the response to these examples? Why didn't Chomsky just give up? The response was to say, grammaticality not just something that you just know. That a sentence like, it's please cold in here, could be grammatical. We can call it grammatical and just call it semantically anomalous. What you do is just redefine what you mean by grammar. Or with something like constructions like, why paint your house purple, he can say, that's not a core construction of English. That's a peripheral construction of English. We're only interested in the core constructions. And what he did over the years was to shrink those core constructions until there are only 30 or 40 of them out of hundreds of constructions in English. So that the result is a theory of grammar that does not apply to very much. It doesn't apply to all of language. It just applies to a very small amount of language. But you only know this if you're inside the theory, if you know it very, very well. Most people who read this and read Chomsky can't understand him very well. If you've tried to read Chomsky, it's difficult sometimes to understand what he's saying. But if you know the inside of the theory, then you know that this is what he's doing. He's shrinking the notion of grammar, or he's changing it in some way so that the theory will stay the same and your understanding of what grammar is will not fit your normal understanding. So one of the commitments that I undertook was to say, I'm going to study all of language, not just the core constructions. And I'm going to study language as it's used in context among people, not just language independent of context and people. Now, that is a commitment as a scientist. I could have done something else. I could have said, I'm only going to study those things that work according to this theory, or I'm only going to study these 30 constructions, and that's all I'll do. People could do that, but I refuse to do it. I mean, that's a commitment that I made personally. So, as a result, what I had to do was give a theory of how meaning could affect grammar. And that's what generative semantics was about. Is there, is that better? Worse? That's, how's that? Better? Yes. Okay, I'm sorry. Is that better? Okay. So, by the way, if you can't hear me at any time, just wave and I'll go and do that. Now, in transformational grammar, generative grammar just has to do with having some means of characterizing. Generating just means characterizing a set by some principles. And there are two very different ways in which you can characterize an infinite set. You can try to have principles that go step by step and generate them by a sequence of steps. These are called transformations. Or you could have your principles simply be static and give constraints so that you can have what is called a constraint satisfaction system. And generative semantics was a constraint satisfaction system. It says there are certain constraints that fit in the language, and so is cognitive linguistics. It too is a constraint satisfaction system. It gives certain principles, and then in a given sentence, 10 of these principles may work at once. In transformational grammar, the principles work one at a time in sequence, and they require a derivation. And that requires a first step of the derivation, which is called an underlying structure. Now, in Chomsky's early work, he used the term deep structure, but he gave that up by 1967 because I gave proofs that there couldn't exist such things. It turns out that a deep structure, in Chomsky's sense, had to also fit meaning. And when he saw that meaning was entering into all sorts of ways, he gave up that condition that the deep structure determined the meaning, and he called these initial structures D structures. D, but that does not mean deep. It's just D, sort of a continuation. He dropped out one of the conditions. Now, so he has to have an initial structure from which the others can be derived. I tried working with this system for many years, and I tried adapting it to generative semantics. So what I tried to do was say that the underlying structure was its logical form, and that from its logical form you could derive in various steps the surface form. And in 1974, I came upon a set of sentences that could not be done this way. These are sentences that cannot have any deep structure or destructure or underlying structure with transformations. Let me give you an example of such a sentence, and I think I'd better write it on the blackboard because it may not be easy to understand. You can say a sentence, like take a simple case. See, I invited you'll never guess who to the party. Now compare that to you'll never guess who I invited to the party. Okay? So the you'll never guess who, this part, occurs, this is the normal way to say the sentence. In simple constructions of English, you'll never guess who I invited to the party, a simple indirect question here. This occurs here, Compare that with, I invited John to the party. You can say, I invited John to the party. And instead of John, I can say, you'll never guess who. Okay? Now, this is the normal form of this sentence, and this sentence basically means that. And in this sentence, this piece is embedded after the verb guess. So this is an embedded clause. Okay? But here, you'll never guess, which is the top clause, is embedded. It's sort of embedded here, and then you have the who, which forms this noun phrase. And this is the top clause. So at first, when this was first discovered, this sentence was first noticed by a linguist at MIT named Avery Andrews, who had been an undergraduate student of mine at Harvard who went to study with Chomsky. And he found this example. And I got a call from Hadj Ross one day telling me this sentence. And he said, there must be a very strange transformation that takes this top clause, drops off the who, and sticks this part in there. Well, that's an impossible transformation. In the theory of transformational grammar, that could not happen. Very odd. So what I did was I said, look, the first thing you do if you're a grammarian and you find a phenomenon is you see if it iterates. You see if you can do two of them, three of them, four of them. If you can embed one in terms of another, see how they iterate. See if it's not just two, but three, four, five, etc. So I constructed some more examples. You can say, John invited you. Never guess who to you can imagine what kind of a party for. Oh, okay. John invited, you'll never guess who, to you can imagine what kind of a party for God knows what reason on wasn't it last Tuesday? Now, John invited, you'll never guess who, to, you can imagine what kind of a party. For, God knows what reason, on, wasn't it last Tuesday? What is the deep structure of this sentence? Or the D structure, or the underlying structure? It has none. Notice that here, this is an underlying structure. You'll never guess who John invited, but so is this. You can imagine what kind of a party John invited someone to. That's also an underlying semantic structure or deep structure. But so is this. God knows for what reason John invited someone to a party. And so is this. Wasn't it last Tuesday that John invited someone to a party for some reason? That is, if you try to give a single underlying structure for that sentence within a theory of transformational grammar, you will fail. There, try it. Go home for homework if you're doing taking a course in transformational grammar, and just try it. because each of these pieces underlined is part of the highest sentence from a deep structure point of view, an underlying structure point of view, but they don't fit together in some way, in any way. It's like you have four sentences coming together, lots of different clauses fitting together in a way that makes sense. That is, grammar has to do with, and this construction has to do with, fitting pieces together under certain conditions. Now, what are the conditions? Notice what you cannot say, right? You cannot say, John invited Harry guessed who to the party. You can only say, you'll never guess who, right? So take this. John invited Harry guessed who to the party. No good. You can say, Harry guessed who John invited to the party, but you can't put it in here. You can say, John invited God knows who to the party, but you can't say, John invited God doesn't know who to the party. Right? The constraint on what can go here is that it must be an exclamation. You must be exclaiming on how extreme this is. And only certain constructions express exclamations. So you can say, God knows how, you know, when the sun will shine again. But not, God doesn't know when the sun will shine again, right? You can say, you'll never guess when spring will come. You know, but not, yeah, but you know, that's an exclamation. But if you say, Bill guessed when spring will come, that's not an exclamation. Only expressions that express exclamations fit here regardless of the grammar used to express them. The condition is a pragmatic condition on the grammar. The condition on what you are expressing. That should never happen in a generative grammar where meaning is ignored, where exclamation should not be part of how things fit together, but it happens in English. It does not fit any Chomskyan account of grammar. Right? Now, let me give you another example like this. There are certain kinds of constructions that are supposed to only occur as main clauses. So, for example, do you all know who, can you hear me? Back there, yes, thank you. Just better? Can you hear me now? Good, thank you. Do you all know who the basketball player Yao is? Okay. What team does he play for?
Rockets.
So, consider the following sentence. Who could stop Yao? Right? It is an exclamation, and it's a question that isn't really a question. It is expressing a negative statement, that no one can stop Yao. Okay? If I say, who could stop Yao? It means no one can stop Yao. Okay? As opposed to, who stopped Yao yesterday? Shaquille O'Neal. Okay? Okay. Who stopped Yao? Not an exclamation. Does not express the negative. But who could stop Yao? Expresses the negative. You can say John believes that no one can stop Yao, but not John believes who could stop Yao. You cannot make it into a relative clause. You can stop. You not say, Yao is the person that John believes who could stop. Impossible. Can't be a relative clause. Can't be a complement of something like believe or say. Now, there is, however, one place in English where it can be embedded. Okay? And it's in a sentence like this. The Rockets, can you hear me? Are going to win because who could stop Yao? Okay? It occurs in this because clause. Notice it does not occur in every embedded clause. You cannot say the Rockets are going to win if who could stop Yao. You can say the Rockets are going to win if no one can stop Yao, but not if who could stop Yao. That is, English has a very interesting construction with a because clause at the end of a sentence where you can have an exclamation that expresses a meaning that can fit in the because clause. The meaning is a negative meaning. So under those conditions, you can have this sentence, but you can't do it with if, only because. Now, think about what this means for a theory of grammar. It means that this exclamation, which means something else, it means a negative statement. That is, if you have a sentence with because and the meaning of that is a negative statement, you can express it with this. In the theory of grammar, could you tell exactly where who could stop Yao can occur without looking at what it meant? And the answer is no. That is, this construction depends upon knowing that only exclamations expressing negative statements can occur here, and that means you have to use the concept exclamation, which is a pragmatic concept, and you have to use the concept express, which has to do with meaning. That's the only way you can account for this phenomenon in the grammar of English. Okay? So now, think about what we have. We have cases where you have to look at indirect speech acts that are in the grammar of English, like who could stop Yao, to understand the grammar. You have cases where, like these that we just saw, where there can be no deep structure. You have cases where the semantics is determining the choice of grammatical expression. That is, in short, the basic claim behind generative linguistics is false. Massively false. These are not rare examples. There are hundreds of examples like this. They're not rare, and they were published all by 1974. So they're in the literature, and anyone who believes in generative grammar ignored them. They decided they're going to do it anyway and change, and just ignore these sentences and only look at core grammar. Okay? Now, let's look at another part of Chomsky's more recent theories. By more recent, I mean after 1966. Having started studying with Chomsky in 1962, that seems more recent to me. In 1966, there was a proposal made by one of Chomsky's students, Ray Jackendoff, to claim that the structure of sentence structure was based on heads and modifiers. This is the so-called X-bar theory. And in an X-bar theory, the assumption was that nouns were N0s and verbs were V0s, and then there were N-bars and V-bars and so on, and N-double bars, and that there were certain kinds of rules that allowed one to look at things like this, that the sentence was like a V-double bar, and that in particular, if you looked at this part of this system, it was claimed that that N bars, the lowest N bar, could take a complement. Sorry, this was a, this N0 can take a complement and become an N bar. And that then you could have a modifier like an adjective modifying this N bar over here. Okay, so these are complements, these are adjectives. And Jackendoff's original argument for this had to do with the word one in English. One can be either a number or it can be a pronoun. And it's a pronoun that's indefinite. So you could say, I bought a car and Bill bought one too. I bought a large car and Bill bought a small one, or Bill bought a bought one too. If you say one, it means large car. And the idea here, and you can say, I bought a car with a V6 engine. Here's the complement, car with a V6 engine. I bought a large car with a V6 engine and Bill bought a small one, car with a V6 engine. Can you hear that? Has this gone out again? Okay, and or you can say, I bought a large car with a V6 engine and Bill bought one too, where it has this whole thing. So Jackendoff's hypothesis was that one could refer back to any N bar. Okay, that was the hypothesis. Now, within a few days of that, Hadge Ross and I constructed counterexamples to this, which have been ignored till today, or still ignored. And the counterexamples go like as follows. John bought a large, expensive portrait of the Queen by Smith and Bill. What? A small, cheap portrait of the princess by Jones. Okay? Nice long sentence. Now, where can you put one? And what does one refer to? You can say portrait, no problem. And Bill bought a small, cheap one of the princess by Jones. So one could be an N-bar in this account. But also, you can have, and Bill bought a small one of the princess by Jones. And if you say small one here, it doesn't mean cheap portrait, it means expensive portrait. Or you could say, and Bill bought a cheap one by Jones, a small cheap one by Jones, and that means a cheap one of the Queen. Or you could say, and Bill bought and that's a small cheap one of the Queen. And Bill bought a cheap one by Smith. And that means a small one of the princess. So basically, any combination can be used. Right? And if you put a one there and you drop out one of these modifiers, then it takes the meaning from the previous sentence. Is that all clear? Now, the question is, can one refer back to any particular node in a tree? And the answer is no. Because if, for example, you have something like cheap portrait of the Queen versus cheap portrait of the Queen, you could use one for either of those with a single node, but in fact, you could have it refer to either one of these, and there's no tree that will have a single node in it. So even if you had cheap portrait of the Queen, there would be no node that this one would refer back to. So in short, there can be no rule for the meaning of one that refers back to just a single node with the meaning of that node. That is, it is not a possible rule of transformational grammar. Now, that does not mean there's no rule for it. And in fact, in the neural theory of grammar, there's a perfectly good rule for it. And it's a very simple rule. In the neural theory of grammar, what you're doing here, if you have one, is the following. Notice first that in these sentences you have opposites, large, small, expensive, cheap, things that are mutually exclusive, that cannot both hold, that is, of the Queen, of the Princess, by Smith, by Jones. These are mutually exclusive meanings. In a neural theory of language, how do you express something that is mutually exclusive? The answer is mutual neural inhibition. That neural inhibition is when a neuron fires and stops another one from firing. And there are certain circuits where you have two neurons and they are connected, so if either one fires, it stops the other. Okay? So mutual inhibition is the way you characterize things that are semantically incompatible in a neural theory. So if you have a neural theory and you have a sentence like, John bought a large portrait of the Queen by Smith and Bill bought a cheap one by Jones, okay, this one will refer back to it. What it will do is activate the meanings of everything in this previous noun phrase except what is inhibited by what's in the noun phrase. So cheap will inhibit expensive, and you'll have cheap. By Jones will inhibit Smith. And then the rest will just work. This will refer back to large and of the Queen. And they will be fitted together in a neural theory. This should not be obvious. It is something we haven't discussed the neural theory yet, and we're going to discuss it a bit. But this is how that would be done in a contemporary cognitive theory of construction grammar based on a neural system. That is, these sentences work this way because we're human beings that have brains and where mutual inhibition is possible. They cannot work in any transformational theory where you have to look at the syntax of one. Now, let's look more generally at X-bar theory. And now we'll show that there are sentences where X-bar theory is not possible. There are sentences where you cannot have X-bar theory. So let me give you an example like that. First, you have to understand the claims of X-bar theory. If you have an X-bar theory, it says that a verb agrees, in English you have verb agreement, that the verb agrees with the head of the noun phrase. So the verbs agree with heads. Okay? In terms of selection, verbs select the meaning of the head. They select heads that are compatible with it. So, for example, if you have a verb like believe, believe requires a human being. So you could say, the tall man who I saw yesterday believes so-and-so. Man is what is selected. If I say, the large car that I saw yesterday believes no good. So it's the head that determines the selection. And that's not just true of subjects, it's also true of objects. Secondly, the modifier of the adjective modifies the head. If I have something like large car, large is the modifier, car is the head, large modifies car. All X-bar theories follow those principles. If they don't follow those principles, they're not an X-bar theory. Okay? So those are the basic principles. Now, consider a sentence like, I picked up and drank a large, delicious cup of tea. And the question is, what is the head of cup of tea? Is cup the head or is tea the head? Right? There are two possible X-bar structures here. Right? In one of them, you have cup of tea, where this is the head. So here you have an N0, and then you have some other structure here, whatever it is. Okay, that's, you know, and then some modifiers. This is an N-bar. And then modifiers over here, adjective. In the other theory, in the other analysis, cup is the head, N0. And then this is a prepositional phrase of T. And this is it's a complement. Okay? And this is an N bar. So those are two possible analyses. And under X-bar theory, one of these must be right. And since there's only one of these in this sentence, one must be right, the other must be wrong, because you can't have two analyses at the same time. But you do. In this sentence, neither of these could work. Why? Notice. Pick up is a verb. the verb selects the head. What does pick up select? I picked up the cup. So that says cup should be the head. But I also drank the tea. But that says tea should be the head. But you can't have both at once. But you do. And look at large. Large is a modifier. What does it modify? It modifies the head. Cup. Delicious is a modifier. What does it modify? The head. Tea. X bar theory cannot work for that sentence or any sentence like it. It is a true counterexample to X bar theory. Now, this is not a problem in construction grammar at all. Because in construction grammar, you don't have constraints of it. There is no X bar theory. You can say what things mean, and you can have a construction like cup of tea. Cup of tea is a measure construction, and it has two parts: a physical object that measures something, and the entity it measures. Period. And a modifier can modify the object or what's measured. No problem. Either one, depending on the semantics. So in a construction grammar, this is no problem. But in an X bar grammar, it's impossible. Okay? These are the reasons why I gave up being a transformational grammarian. There's some of the reasons. There are hundreds more like it. But these are some of the reasons why by 1974, I gave it up completely. And all of these examples were known by 1974. That is 30 years ago. I knew all of these, and I said, this cannot work. And went off to do something else. And the something else is called cognitive linguistics, for reasons that we will get to in the next lecture.